Good morning. Welcome to Messiah Lutheran Church on this beautiful, little chilly Sunday morning. We are glad that you are here to worship with us. Just a few announcements for you this morning. I just want to say, first of all, thank you to everyone who came out for the Messiah Coffee House on Friday night. That was a great experience, I hear, and we just want to thank everyone who was involved in putting that together. So thank you to the team. Also want to make sure that you know that our new member class, if you haven't signed up and you're new to Messiah, we have a new member class that starts today, and there's a space for you. So if you want to come be a part of that and see what it is to be a part of Messiah, then we welcome you to do that. It'll be in the one of the Sunday school classrooms. You'll just follow around, and there's a sign. So also, if you are high school to age 20-something, we invite you to come to what's called the Coffee and Catechism class. I'll sit down with you guys and have a moment to talk about the things of the faith and answer questions. So see me if you're interested. And then finally, after the closing of this service, please stick around because Keith Clements is here with a brief presentation about a mission opportunity that our circuit is beginning. So we hope that you will just hang out for just a couple of moments and hear that. It's really exciting news what our circuit as a collection of churches is doing in the area. So I commend that to you. As always, please read your bulletin. And if you're not signed up for the weekly word email that gets sent out every week, please get signed up for that so you know everything that's going on here at Messiah. And I invite you now to please stand as we sing our opening hymn. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord, for it is good to sing praises to our God.
For it is pleasant, and a song of praise is fitting.
The Lord builds up Jerusalem. He gathers the outcasts of Israel.
He heals the brokenhearted, and binds up their wounds.
He determines the number of the stars. He gives to all of them their names.
And abundant in power. His understanding is beyond measure.
The Lord lifts up the humble.
He casts the wicked to the ground.
Beloved in the Lord, recognizing our sinfulness, let us confess to him our sins, that according to the psalmist, he would not cast us to the ground, but lift us up in his mercy. In light of making confession, I invite you to either be seated or you may also kneel. We take this moment now for silent personal confession and self-examination. Together we confess. We are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart, and we have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. Heavenly Father, by your might, not one star of the heavenly host is missing. By your power, call the elect out of the darkness of sin and into the marvelous light of your grace, so that the full company of saints is gathered in faith into the body of Christ. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. The one who calls all the starry host by name calls you also by name, and in your baptism has redeemed you and forgives you all your sins for the sake of Christ Jesus. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please rise. Merciful Lord, you have granted us a new identity and life in Christ our Lord. Keep us, we pray, in this faith and life in Christ that we may know with confidence we belong to you and live secure in this knowledge, both now and forevermore. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, whom with you and the Holy Spirit are one God, one Lord, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated for the reading of God's word.
In today's Old Testament lesson, the prophet Isaiah reminds his hearers that God, the Holy One, has power and strength, and he displays this for the benefit of his people. And as a choir member, I'm going to give you a little heads up. You're going to hear a portion of that same message that you hear in the reading in our choir anthem for this morning. So be tuned in for that. The reading from Isaiah chapter 40. Do you not know? Do you not hear? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he who sits above the circle of the earth, and all the inhabitants are like grasshoppers. He who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to dwell in. He who brings princes to nothing and makes the rulers of the earth as emptiness. Scarcely are they planted, scarcely sown. Scarcely has their stem taken root in the earth when he blows on them and they wither and the tempest carries them off like stubble. To whom then will you compare me? That I should be like him, says the Holy One. Lift up your eyes on high and see. Who created these? He who brings out their host by number, calling them all by name, by the greatness of his might, and because he is strong in power, not one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God? Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is an everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint, and to him who has no might, he increases strength. Even youths shall faint and be weary, and young men shall fall exhausted. But they who wait on the Lord will renew their strength. They will mount up with wings like eagles. They will run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. The epistle lesson for this Sunday, the first, is from 1 Corinthians chapter 9, where Paul tells us that as an apostle called by God, he is now under obligation to share the gospel message with everyone. Paul says, "For if I preach the gospel, that gives me no ground for boasting, for necessity is laid upon me. Woe to me if I do not preach the gospel. For if I do this of my own will, I have a reward, but if not of my own will, I am still entrusted with a stewardship. What then is my reward? It's this, that in my preaching I may present the gospel free of charge, so as not to make full use of my right in the gospel. For though I am free from all, I have made myself a servant to all, that I might win more of them. To the Jews, I became as a Jew in order to win the Jews. To those under the law, I became as one under the law, though not myself being under the law, that I might win those under the law. To those outside the law, that is, Gentiles, I became as one outside the law, not being outside the law of God, but under the law of Christ, that I might win those outside the law. To the weak, I became weak, that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all people, that by all means I might save some. I do it all for the sake of the gospel, that I might share with them in its blessings. Do you not know that in a race all the runners run, but only one receives the prize? So run that you may obtain it. Every athlete exercises self-control in all things. They do it to receive a perishable crown, a perishable wreath, but we an imperishable. So I do not run aimlessly. I do not box as one beating the air. But I discipline my body and keep it under control, lest after preaching to others, I myself should be disqualified." This is the word of the Lord.
We We continue in Scripture with our memory verse of the month, so let us say this verse together. This is a new verse for a new month. The Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. So the Son of Man is Lord, even of the Sabbath. Mark 2, 27 and 28. Please rise in honor of the gospel reading. The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the first chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
And immediately he left the synagogue and entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law lay ill with a fever, and immediately they told him about her. And he came and took her by the hand and lifted her up, and the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sundown they brought to him all who were sick or oppressed by demons. And the whole city was gathered together at the door, and he healed many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons. And he would not permit the demons to speak, because they knew him. And rising very early in the morning, while it was still dark, he departed and went out to a desolate place. And there he prayed. And Simon and those who were with him searched for him, and they found him and said to him, "Everyone is looking for you." And he said to them, "Let us go on to the next towns that I might preach there also, for that is why I came out." And he went throughout all Galilee, preaching in their synagogues and casting out demons. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. We continue our service now, called by the gospel to confess our common faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty, from where he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated.
I know we've got some kids here this morning. Here come the girls, all of them, huh? How are you? Yeah, I'll save that for later, okay? Okay, sounds good. All right, well, we're here this morning, and you know what? We've got a problem this morning. It's a sin problem. It's like sin has me all wrapped up. Here, let me show you what it's done. Look at there. I can't use it. Oh, it's not very helpful. I'd like to shake your hand, but I can't. Can you see some of the words that are written on there? Not honest.
Lazy.
Lazy.
Disobedient.
Disobedient.
Not, not helping friends.
Not helping friends. Are those any of your problems too? Maybe, or maybe you have other problems that keep you in, we say, bondage. I mean, I can't do anything with this that's good. It needs to be free. How do we get free from our sin?
By forgiving God.
Think about that. How do we get free from our sin? Who frees us from our sin?
Jesus.
Jesus does. Yes, he does. Look at what I've got on my scissors. What's that?
A cross.
It is a cross. And who died on the cross for us?
Jesus.
That is exactly right. And when he did that, it was as if he was cutting away all of our sin. And now we have, my hand can breathe. Yay! We have freedom in who? Freedom in Jesus, don't we? There it is. Now I can shake hands and help others and do things that I want to do because Jesus loves me, right? And he says, be like me. I can't do that when my hand is bound up like this. But I can do it when I'm free. And we are free in Jesus. We need to pray about that this morning. Bye, Claire. Let's pray. Thank you, Father, for sending your son, Jesus, who freed us from our sins. And now that we're free, we can be like you and do things for others. And we pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, guys, how about a folder? You want to bring one to Claire? Sure. Here you go. Good job.
There's a great little hook here for my cane. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God, our Father, and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, one of the biggest misconceptions, I think, about the Christian faith by people who are not followers of Jesus is that the faith is primarily about keeping a bunch of rules. That the Ten Commandments are really what define the Christian faith, and that those who break the law are guilty of sin and are judged by God and are punished. And while all of this is in the Bible, this is only half the story. We Lutherans call this the law. God's law. So when we encounter a text that speaks of the Christian life as freedom, like in our 1 Corinthians text today, I think it's important for us to slow down and to look at the big picture to really understand what God's word is telling us. I'll be focusing on verse 19 of our epistle reading, which says, where Paul writes, "For though I am free from all, I have made myself a servant to all, that I might win more of them." I once had an unbelieving friend ask me, "How do you live with all the guilt of calling myself a Christian and yet knowing that I break God's rules?" At first, I was startled by this question because as someone who had recently recommitted my life to following Jesus at the time, it was a relief from guilt that gave me peace after years of trying to earn God's favor. We lost touch with each other, this friend and I, when I started going back to church. But I do remember telling her about Jesus' love and forgiveness. And it felt like an introduction of sorts, an introduction that she wasn't ready for. I acknowledged in that conversation that I had been saddled with guilt all of my life because I knew that I wasn't keeping God's commands perfectly. The thing is, we all know God's law, don't we? The Bible tells us that God's law is written on our hearts. So even for those outside of the church, they understand God's law. Our sinful nature tries to deal with that by denying that we are sinners or hiding it or minimizing our sin. But we know in our hearts that we are guilty. The Bible says we are bound by sin, like that illustration in the children's message that Paula just gave. We are tied up, held captive. John chapter 8 says, everyone who practices sin is a slave to sin. God's law is good because it shows us our sin like a mirror, and it shows us our need for help, for healing, to be set free. This is called the second use of the law in the small catechism. Our confirmands here know that well because we've been covering that recently. The second use of the law is a reminder that we are sinners, that God's judgment is surely coming. Hebrews 9 warns that it is appointed once for man to die, and then comes judgment. Sin makes slaves and prisoners of us all. We lock ourselves up when we sin, and we try to make ourselves feel better by locking others up when they sin against us. See, look at their sin. Don't look at mine. Look at their sin. As if focusing on other people's sin minimizes our own. I once heard a pastor paraphrase the fifth petition of the Lord's Prayer by saying, "Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin differently than we do." It's a good point. The point is that Christ didn't come to set us free so that we could become the morality police and lock other people up or ourselves up when we fail to keep God's law. Christ set us free from the eternal consequences of sin so that we can now be witnesses to His grace and His mercy and His love. We do this best when we share with others the forgiveness that God has given to us. I have a video this morning that Molly, I hope you can pull up, that illustrates that. Take a look here on the screen. Isn't it?
Miss Paula showed it to the confirmands, and I know it's your second time around, but there's always more you can draw from it. But how did you feel there at the beginning? And then you notice when they made the turn. Did you notice that as the words of forgiveness started to flow, these are all words straight from Scripture. You know, when we are confronted by the law, that one half of the Bible, we're given two choices, right? We can either try to hide it, deny it, run away from it, whatever, or we can step into the gospel. And that's what this verse is about here in 1 Corinthians. You know, even as I started coming back to church, I was still trying to earn God's forgiveness by doing more good than evil or trying to be better than the next guy. Have you ever played that game with God? It doesn't work. Until I really started listening to God's word and to the sermons in church that expounded on scriptures like this one, where the Apostle Paul puts God's law into perspective by introducing them to a new word, oiangelion. I know you guys use it every day. It's Greek, right? It means the good news, the gospel, oiangelion. Woe to me if I do not preach the gospel, Paul writes. Just a note about the use of this word gospel that'll set some context for us in this year B of the lectionary. I want to give it to you here. Mark, which is the gospel that we're focused on this church year, Mark uses the word gospel more times than the other three gospel writers combined. So you're going to see that in the readings, in the gospel readings coming up this year. So look for that. I also wanted to point out that in this chapter of 1 Corinthians, Paul uses it more times than any other chapter in the whole New Testament, gospel. 9 times. This isn't just good news, you guys. We call it the good news, but it isn't just the good news. I like how Mercy Me says it in that song on the radio, on K-Love, or his radio. It's not the good news, it's the best news ever, right? Understanding the gospel is critical to understanding the Christian faith, because to try to live by the law in our own strength, by our own willpower, is to completely misunderstand the significance of who Jesus is and why he came into the world. The gospel is the new teaching that we heard about last week in the Gospel of Mark. Remember, Jesus brought a new teaching with authority, even healing on the Sabbath, which is why that's our memory verse, right? We're focusing on Jesus' authority, that he can heal even on the Sabbath, right? He's even Lord of the Sabbath, the verse says. Because Jesus is the Son of God, he speaks with all authority. He came into the world not only to speak and teach, however, he came to set us free from sin through his life and his death and his resurrection. This is what we mean when we say that Jesus is both the messenger who speaks God's truth and the message who reveals God's love and salvation by what he did for us. Jesus is just getting started here in this first chapter of Mark, where we are in the story right now, by working miracles, healing Simon's mother-in-law. Hang on. The best is yet to come. Even if you have heard these stories 1,000 times before, listen again with new ears as we hear the historical accounts of seemingly impossible works by this man from Galilee who has the authority to heal the sick and to drive out demons and give sight to the blind and to set captives like us free. Paul experienced this freedom firsthand, didn't he? You remember on the road to Damascus when he encountered the living Christ in the book of Acts, and it changed his life.
From that day forward, Paul would grow in his understanding of what this freedom was for, which was given freely to him. So here in this letter to the Corinthian church, Paul does not boast in himself or in his authority. Paul trusts so deeply that God provides for all his needs of body and soul that he has been set free to share freely the best news ever with others. Paul is ultimately bound only by the law of love, which he will get to in chapter 13 of 1 Corinthians. We all know that chapter well, don't we? The love chapter. Heard it virtually every wedding, I think. In short, Paul says here, if I have all powers, know all things, have all faith, but do not have love, I am nothing, and I gain nothing. It is only the power of the gospel that truly changes the hearts of sinful man and gives us the capacity to walk with compassion alongside another person and seek to share the love of the gospel in our words and in our actions, to become all things to all people, that we might win some. Sometimes this requires us to put other people's rights even before our own or their preferences. So Paul writes, to the Jews I became as a Jew in order to win the Jews. To those under the law I became as one under the law, though not myself being under the law, that I might win those under the law. To the weak I became weak that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all people, that by all means I might save some. I do it all for the sake of the gospel, that I may share with them in its blessings. Sharing in these blessings happens within the context of the church, and I hope we never take that for granted. The church is where the word of the gospel is preached and the sacraments of forgiveness are given. Let us never take this for granted. This week I encourage you to reflect on these words from the Apostle Paul in Scripture and ask yourself, what is my freedom for? How does God want me to use my freedom to share in the blessings of forgiveness and grace and the hope of eternal life with others? The privilege of God's forgiveness that we have in Christ is a free gift given to us, though it cost Jesus everything. But sharing in these blessings that Paul writes about is not free for us. It takes effort on our part, discipline, Paul says in the last verse. As we look at the beginning of another Lent in about 10 days, we remember again the price that Jesus paid to set us free from our sin. And I invite you again into the discipline of giving something up for this season in preparation for Holy Week. Giving up a pleasure or maybe a time-consuming habit that is a worthy discipline really for us, that can help us be more mindful of God's presence in our lives, in our relationships, in our world. But I also encourage you, as you think about giving something up, you think about adding something for Lent as well. Maybe you could give up 30 minutes of time on your phone each day, and you could add that time spent in the Word or in prayer or in making an effort to contact a friend or family member you haven't heard from in some time, and sharing the blessings that God has given you and recognize the blessings that God has given them. Or you could give up that Starbucks coffee and collect the money to use for our Share Sunday food collection, which is this week. Christ and the gospel has set us all free. So now, like Paul, we are free indeed. Free to share what we have been given,
the best news ever with those that God has put in our lives, that they too might know Jesus and share in the blessings of God's kingdom with us. In a few minutes at the end of the service, Keith and Connie Clements are going to stand up and tell us about an opportunity to extend those blessings beyond the walls of this church, as our circuit is planning a church plant in Gastonia. It's the first church plant in decades in this circuit, but it's an opportunity to extend the gospel to that area of Charlotte, the greater area. And so I invite you, as you hear their presentation, that you think about how God might be calling you to participate, whether directly or indirectly. It's exciting to see God on the move in Charlotte and in our lives. And now may the peace, which surpasses all understanding, may it keep our hearts and our minds in our chain breaker, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. At this time, we bring to the Lord our tithes and offerings. Thank you.
Having been redeemed and set free by God's mercy and grace, we now have the opportunity to pray for all those around the world. So let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Let us pray. We give thanks to you, dear Father, for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, into our flesh to proclaim the gospel and to set us free from bondage to sin. By your word, rescue us from every evil of body and soul. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord of the church, give joy to your servants on whom you have laid the necessity to preach the gospel, that many would be saved in every nation, and that together we may share in the blessings of Christ. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, give to all Christian homes the endurance that comes from your Holy Spirit, that husbands and wives, parents and children, may be disciplined and self-controlled in their duties, run their course in this life, and continue to the end in the holy Christian faith, ready to receive the imperishable wreath of eternal life. We pray especially for our families of the week, for Timmy Taylor, Timmy Adams and Ivy Fletcher, for Jen Allen and Gracie and John McCray, for Tina, Ruby and Nico Alvarado, for John and Pat Ames, for David, Sarah, and Asa Anders, and also for our preschool families of the month, the Jane, Kulkarni, Kumar, Milks, and Nielsen families, the Chahwan, the Garishade, Godin, Gopinath, and Johnston families. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Almighty God, creator of the world and of all of its foundations, you hold sway over the powers of nature and the rulers of the earth. Graciously preserve our land, its produce and industry, and our leaders together with our people. Do not disregard us for our sins, but renew us, that our lives may be peaceful and our country governed according to your will. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O Lord, your Son is the great physician of body and soul, at whose hand demon, disease, and every ill must turn away. We bring before you those in any need and ask that you would grant patience in affliction and healing and relief from any and all suffering according to your good and gracious will. We pray especially for Jerry Hinke, giving you thanks that he has returned home from a hospital stay and that he's getting medical care that he needs. We pray also for Jeff Kalfleisch, thankful that he has come through surgery, and we ask that you would give him continued healing and give traveling mercies to Marion and Orv. We also pray for healing for Amy Cronin, and for Pastor Lloyd Ginn, and we give you thanks that he is also home from the hospital. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Holy Father, where there is forgiveness of sins, there is also life and salvation. Bring us in faith to your holy sacrament, that in the blood of Christ, which atoned for our sins, may make us whole, strengthen us against every spiritual attack of the devil, turn us in love toward our neighbor, and preserve us in body and soul to life everlasting. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend these petitions, asking you would grant them and whatever else you know which is needful, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now we are bold to pray the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please rise. As we begin the order of the sacrament. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, Everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. For what had been hidden from before the foundation of the world, you have made known to the nations in your Son. In him being found in the substance of our mortal nature, you have manifested the fullness of your glory. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and singing. On the night when our Lord Jesus Christ was betrayed, he took bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way, also after the supper was finished, he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my shed blood, poured out for the forgiveness of all of your sins. This do as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Amen. You may be seated.
Mercy.
Please rise. Let us pray. Merciful Lord, in your great love, you have brought us from death to life, forgiven all our sins, and made us your children. Grant to us not only the healing of the ills of this life, but the perfect healing of everlasting life, which we have already tasted in this blessed communion. Deliver us from pride and arrogance, and build within us a servant's heart, that we may love you above all things, and our neighbor as you have loved us. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Amen. And we sing our closing hymn.
Thank you.
Now go in peace, join Jesus on his mission in the power of his Spirit. Thanks be to God.
Well, if everybody could just take a quick seat for a moment. I got some exciting news and information. So, good morning, everyone. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Connie and I, my better half, we're still members of the church. It's probably been a few years since we've been fully engaged here, but so I guess I would say the prodigal son returns. So it's great to see some wonderful and beautiful faces here we've served with for many years. We wanted to come back this morning just briefly to share with you some exciting news. And I'm going to go ahead and try to advance this slide. And there it is. Okay, so there's the theme and logo of some exciting news that's coming to the Gaston County area, specifically around the Gastonia, is chosen for such a time as this, obviously from the book of Esther, about courage and, you know, saving God's people. Well, we felt that theme and that logo is really very, very relevant to this mission. Connie and I have been, we live down in Lake Wylie. We've been down there serving, created a ministry within our church and within our neighborhood during the pandemic for about 40 residents that live on our peninsula, and we get together monthly and worship and study. So now we felt over the last year that God has been leading us to start a new church plant in that Gaston area. And the great news is that we're getting support from all the churches here, all the LCMS churches in the Carolina region. So there's at the end of when you walk out, Connie and I will be back in the back handing you a flyer on all the information. But as you can see up there, it is going to be, the kickoff meeting will be on February 25th, Sunday, February 25th from 2 to 4 p.m. So we'll have all the church pastors here, the LCMS pastors in the circuit will be attending, and hopefully a lot of lay people from all the various churches to come out to support it, right? Interesting, on the right side of that slide, Pastor Patton referenced it during his sermon, and it's been almost 20 years since there's been a church plant by the LCMS in the Carolina area. 20 years. So I would say it's time, right? It is time for us to start a new plant, another church in this area. We believe the Lord is leading us to do this. And we would love for your help and support. The objectives of this meeting that we're going to have, and it'll be a celebration, is really to be guided by the Spirit and God's will to be done, not what our will be done, but His will be done through us in coming to the community in the Gaston area. We want to form a group of people that will buy in and get committed to this church plant and build relationships in the area. We want a good turnout. We want to pack the YMCA there. And that's where it's going to be, at the YMCA in Gastonia. The agenda will be, we'll have a registration, fellowship gathering, music and prayer. Kirk Himes and Jared will be there from the LCMS to kick us off. Pastor Harmon, our president of the circuit, will be there. So if you haven't had a chance to meet this very, very talented Reverend, he has a great message to share, the importance of this, and he's making the time to be there. And then we'll have music and prayer, and then I'll close it out. So it'll be a lot of fun. It's going to be an exciting time, and we just want everybody to come out and just be there for it, to support it. One more advance here. I got to be patient, I think. Okay, so here's the approach we have. Starts with prayer. We've been praying for a couple months over this. It always should start and end with prayer, right? We want to gain feedback from the residents of the area. We're going to do a demographic and graphical assessment. That's like an example of, we have a number of different areas that will look at population growth and trends, demographics around income and, you know, schools and all kinds of different metrics that we will look at as well, that God will use, you know, allow us to use technology to through prayer to put that church in where he wants us to put it, right? How can you help? Prayer, 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 and more prayer. Please keep us in your prayers. Come to the event. It would be great. We just to fill it out. Just be a witness to all the people that are coming into the YMCA that day, you know, to exercise, to see all these Christians come to that meeting room there that we're going to fill up, and to praise the Lord and see where he's going to take us. Give your time. Financial assistance. We have actually good financial, some dollars from seed money to get us started, but we're setting up an account here at Messiah for that you can donate towards it. And then resource assistance. You know, as we build this thing out, wherever it goes, you know, this is, you know, we're going to need resources, you know, not just financial resources, but human resources and all kinds of things. So if you come, you'll get some swag here. So we're going to have some shirts. I think I had it up there. We're going to have these shirts. I got to be patient. Patient. That's Connie says that all the time. All right. So be patient. There it is. Stop. Okay. So we're going to have these shirts, you know, chosen with, you know, for such a time as this. We're going to have coffee mugs, all kinds of fun things to hand out. So if you go, you've come, you'll be part of the movement, right? You'll be part of the mission. And again, we would love to have you there. We love for your prayer and support. And again, thank you for your time this morning. I told Pastor I cut it short, but it's great to see everybody. God bless you, and thank you for your support for this new, exciting church plant. Have a blessed day.